Herzlich willkommen, liebe Lebensformen, hier im Stream der Chaoszone. Herzlich willkommen hier in der Chaoszone. Der Vortrag, den wir jetzt hören, der ist von Carola und Roberto Küpfer und handelt um Barrierefreiheit. Das habt ihr vielleicht schon auf vielen Behörden.
The talk we're about to hear is going to be about accessibility. You've probably read about it on official, on authority websites. But what else is it about? So welcome, Carola and Roberto. How to digitale Barrierefreiheit? The stage is yours.
John, Na? Carola,
you can start.
Leg los.
Ja, ich brauche kurz.
I need some feedback if I can be heard.
Nice to have. Sonst fange ich einfach mal an. Wunderbar.
Yeah, welcome.
Herzlich willkommen zum
to this talk. How to do accessibility? That's an exciting topic. Also, with this picture here, which is not accessible.
Begonnen werden soll, möchten uns heute
we want to talk about this, but we want to make you happy, but also disappoint you at the same time, because it is a really big topic, and we can't cover it all. So this is a very wide-going topic, and it's about recommendations, and also it's a starting point for further developments, and it is about just tell you the basic points of this topic. Our background is the talk we will give with two of us. So there's a computer scientist here. I'm Carola. And my partner is here, Robert. So my background is social education. Within I'm tech savvy, but I'm not from in a school. But that's a great mixture for the topic of accessibility. So one person knows the computers, and the other knows the humans. So let's start. That's always a good combination, right? So why do you think this topic is important? So accessibility is with this kind of weird term of it's for disabled people. So I researched a little bit. So for the minister for work and social issues, the impairments, which 16% of the people have. So it is like 7 million of people, 10%. 7 to 10% of the people in Germany have accepted impairment, bad or chronic disease. So why is this topic still interesting? So we think about demographics, and so 18 to 20% of the people in Germany are older than 50. So that group is growing, and so accessibility and digital participation is very important. So what means access and being part of it? So it's about political decision making and creating your environment. It's not so definitely designed. So what means digital? So it's about accessibility to digital infrastructures. That means I can participate in the digital network. It has to do with accessible technologies like computers, smartphones, and other devices. They have to be accessible, and it's also about free or cheap internet connection. So one point here is Freifunk. and also the debate how much a hard sphere for how much money should be available for that. So it's also about using the technology for all, I mean, of all groups of people and group specific offers. It's about information and so being able to inform myself about current rules about, I mean, during this pandemic right now. There's one example, there's the public broadcast. Everybody can use it if you, regardless if you have visual impairments or hearing impairments, and that is has effects in everyday works. So it has to do with how I can organize myself. So on the next slide, it's about digital participation.
It means support through education offerings, through lowering of barriers so that everybody can participate digitally. Participation means the concrete option of expressing yourself online, for example, through petitions, which is very widespread today. But it has to be accessible to people, even, for example, who can't see. So they too need to be able to submit an online petition. And thirdly, we need transparency. So the availability of information and the presentation of information. You might know the dashboard from Germany's Robert Koch Institute. There's a lot of animation, for example, and it's always questionable if everybody can actually experience this. If everybody can access this information. So this transparency in the publication of information plays a central role in digital participation. There are legal foundations as well. The first of these is the UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities, which was ratified in Germany in 2009. And all the authorities, be that education, universities, whoever, there's no longer any debate about if this should be, if accessibility is relevant. The only debate is on how it should be implemented. And I like to say this because in my experience, accessibility has often been seen as an add-on in universities, where it's only ever the last step. It's never really part of the process. And now there's an actual... Now, universities are actually forced to think about accessibility up front, and all the states that have ratified these conventions have to create equal access to information technologies. And especially in education, this means
that
participation for everybody has to be enabled. There are further interesting legal foundations. The DIN ISO, which treats the ergonomics of human-machine interactions. There is an EU norm on digital accessibility, and it's relevant for public procurement. So, for example, if you're writing programs that are going to be procured by certain authorities, then they have to bear this in mind. Thirdly, we have the Web Accessibility Directive, which is also a European norm. And for Germany, it's now a legal norm, both federally, but also in the individual states. This has been forced since the 23rd of September of this year, but the implementation has been very variable. But web pages have to be accessible. They have to have an accessibility policy, and they have to explain why certain things aren't being implemented. And laziness or lack of money can't be a reason. But for example, there has to be, it might be a schedule. For example, if you have archived material, it's probably reasonable that it might take 5 years or something to make it accessible. But information that's published today about, for example, where people can get vaccinated or about infection rates, those have to be accessible, but they often aren't, unfortunately. There's another directive on this topic, which I'm going to explain in more detail later on. But first, what is a barrier or an impediment to accessibility? The German dictionary defines it as an obstacle or something that that keeps somebody out, and it the word obstacle comes from French, which means, well, exactly a barrier, an obstacle, something, doesn't let somebody through. And these are often, well, there are variable barriers. For example, someone with a walking impairment, such as me, there are physical barriers that can be really irritating, like a set of stairs, for example. For older people, technical barriers might be a cause. That includes also the ability to operate certain devices. So barriers are a huge topic.
Da hake ich jetzt vielleicht mal ein. Also es gibt diese Sprechweise, dass man das mal versteht, was mit diesem Barrierefrei auf sich hat. Gibt halt Menschen,
there are people with impairments. If the surroundings don't work, then the barriers turn into impairments, and that means that people are impaired in their expressing themselves.
Und es ist im digitalen Bereich eben sehr wichtig, weil halt auch immer mehr.
And it's important because more things are happening digitally these days. And until 2015,
bis halt diese neue Verordnung kam, jetzt
not a lot happened, but now this is actually becoming relevant with the implementation of this directive.
Nicht nur so eine Definition unter Informatikern oder Soziologen.
It's not just a question for a computer scientist, but it's also a question for the actual rules and regulations here. And this is an exciting topic because accessibility here is already written and described in the law. Here we have this rule number 4.
Allgemein üblichen Weise ohne besondere Erschwernis.
So we're talking about the definition of accessibility here. We're saying that the technical information has to be both accessible and it has to be usable to the end users.
Im Zweifel sogar klagen, also dieses barrierefrei, das war aber nicht so rum, obwohl ich den Eindruck habe, sondern es ist tatsächlich in Deutschland.
It's actually here in Germany's already defined here. And then this is a good basis of the technical side, how this is actually done. So then next comes the question: how do you implement it? How do humans use computers?
Und da finde ich sozusagen meinen gedanklichen Schritt zurück.
And then thinking about what I've written here.
Mit Beeinträchtigungen einen
How is here written on the side?
Du hast den alten Mac ausgegraben, der ist ja geil.
And here it's funny how the Mac is actually shown on the slide.
Überlegen, ich weiß nicht, also mancher von euch kennt ja halt einfach jemanden,
Someone
oder hat einen Zugang.
Might already know this or already has access to it.
Normal entsprechen, also für den Computer zwei Hände haben.
When you have two hands to use the computer and then are trying to steer the computer or thinking about how you're going to use it.
Wie nutze ich es, wenn ich gar nichts hören kann?
How do you use this if you can't hear, for example?
Das ist ja einfach zu machen. Ist auch ja eine Einleitung, sich da selber mal in die Spur zu begeben zu gucken.
You have to look what are available for different gadgets. Above on the left, we have a keyboard.
Die hat eine, ja, eine Braillezeile.
We have Braille available there.
Zum Beispiel Dinge ausgegeben werden.
Also and wenn then Text, when there's lesen, text that you're trying to read,
then
you can actually read through a PDF.
Oder keine sehr eingeschränkte Sehfunktion haben. Und da ist es zum Beispiel möglich,
and it's possible
wenn das hergestellt
when
ist,
something is manufactured Zeile, that you have something actually readable.
Braille, also die Braille-Schrift quasi, hebt sich hoch und ich kann das dann ertasten.
Then it's actually communicated to the keys on the keyboard.
Frage, wie wird denn jetzt der Rechner bedient, wenn ich nicht sehe Ausgabe?
And then if you can't see, how do you actually use the computer? How do you give commands to it? Over on the right hand side, the first slide there.
Nachschlagen oder vielleicht mal eine Einrichtung bei euch um die Ecke mal besuchen oder fragen.
So when you're visiting something,
zum Beispiel beim Chaos-Treff Chemnitz,
for example,
genau, da liegt eine Braille-Zeile.
And there's different examples of this available.
Links unten ist zum Beispiel ein Pad.
On the left side, under, we have a pad there.
Nutzen, um einfache Kommunikation zu ermöglichen.
And this is to actually make communication easier.
Unter schwerkörperlichen Behinderungen nicht sprechen.
So if someone, for instance, can't speak, and you need some sort of service, you say, oh, I'm thirsty, I would like something, I have a question. And then we have this Macintosh picture on the lower right, and then you have the camera there.
And when you
use the system, you can steer with your eyes where.
Aber das ist tatsächlich auch sehr
through eye tracking.
Wirklich am Computer entlang geht.
And then you can steer or give commands through
also
the camera just by eye movements. That's a quick impression of what's available.
Genau.
Ja, mach mal. Was ich das nochmal anders zu
And then also, let's put together some other things here.
Was sind überhaupt diese Probleme?
So what are the problems here that people might have?
Als Software oder Inhalte.
So what's the problem with using softwares or using the content of it? There are people who are blind
die brauchen einen Screen
and then they need a screen reader
benutzen eine Braille-Zeile.
Or
screen readers sind sehr populär,
something that outputs in Braille that they can read.
Verstehen das dann auch? Für die ist dann zum Beispiel wichtig, dass in der Anwendung
ein
Tab-Order ist.
If they have a Braille, that they can use this Braille to then navigate a website.
Eine Hundertschaft
an use a Braille display.
Durchlesen muss, bevor man dann endlich mal wieder an das Menü hinkommt.
And then they can go, actually navigate to the menu, to the menu.
Und dann auch tatsächlich dahin navigieren.
And then go through the menu to navigate further.
Taub und blind.
And when someone is deaf and blind, then you can have both the Braille output, the Braille display,
der Blinde, der kann jetzt nicht unbedingt mit der Maus,
and then when you're blind, you can't move with the mouse.
Beschränkt geht es natürlich schon,
and so it's very limited, but in principle, you can still then give your commands through this interface.
When you're deaf, aber die haben durchaus Leseschwierigkeiten,
then they can't read. They have a problem.
Von der Akustik her
they have problems with the acoustics
die sind halt
then.
Sehr aber da kann es dann nicht passieren, dass ein Video kommt.
And then there's a problem then with actually accessing videos this sein, way. So you're getting the not the visuals, but just the audio output this way. And then you need a translation from the video into an audio description. The technology in this case is actually not so developed yet.
Mir bisher nicht bekannt.
It's not known to me if this is available.
Dann gibt's die Leute, die können sehen,
and then there's other people who can see, but they can't see so well. So this is when they call legally blind, for instance.
Oder in ihre grafischen
you need a graphical user interface that is in high contrast or actually made very large then. This could be maybe a larger monitor or making the symbols on the screen very large.
Auch so Sachen wie, dass der Eingabekursor bei der Tastatur.
And then also to see the pointer on the screen is important. You need a little, for instance, if you're making a small mark on the paper, it's then too small for people who are legally blind to see.
Oben und unten auszustatten, damit man den sieht, oder einen Mauszeiger,
so where the mouse is, needs to be seen by people.
Das Problem für Inhalte,
a problem with the content who are developing it,
das Programm noch ordentlich
um. Then how, sieht man da was? How are you seeing the output of the
da darf man halt
program?
Dann nicht sagen, nicht Texte schreiben wie die Fehler befinden sich in den rot markierten
so
Texten.
So there's, for instance, when you're making an error, you might make an error on the text that's seen in red. But if you have red-green color blindness, you're not going to be able to see this as well. And then you have people who are sensitive to light, and we have as a solution the dark mode. Then there's also physical disabilities, physical problems.
You
could have a brighter slide in the foreground, and then there will be higher contrast between them and more visible. And then you have dark rooms. And then you would have a specialized monitor that would go together well with this room to work in. Then you have sensory problems and movement problems, and then in this case you would have problems accessing the keyboard, and then maybe a joystick would be a solution to address this problem.
Dann gebe ich wieder.
So we're going to the next slide here.
Ich habe das vorhin schon mal unter gesetzliche Grundlagen kurz angedeutet. Barrierefreie Informationstechnik Verordnung fällt unter die Kategorie wie.
This isn't extensively documented, this or this directive, but there are some important points, and I can really recommend having a look through it. But I can tell you that the German translation has some errors. It goes back to the well, it's a translation, and when you translate, you often make mistakes, and you make you know, the content can change slightly. So I would recommend looking at the original.
Ja, wie wird Barrierefreiheit in Technik hergestellt? Also
how can accessibility be created in digital documents? You have to have a searchable text and easy navigation abilities.
Zeilen verlassen muss oder
it doesn't work if you have to have to rely on taps and lines.
Maus nicht benutzen kann.
There's relevance for speech, text-to-speech output. It's really important for images. I mean, you may have heard that a picture is worth 1,000 words, but it doesn't help you if you can't actually see the picture. So you need alternative descriptions of the images. And that could be, for example, this picture shows a wheelchair, or should you explain what exactly happens in the image? It very much depends on the use case. For example, if you're using the photo in teaching and you would like students to learn something from the image, you have to describe the image. On the other hand, if I only use the image to just to make the page look less empty, I have to either write an but that it's presentational, or I just don't give it an alt attribute, and then it won't be announced at all. So in a classical text document, you can set a language for the document so that screen readers, which are a very useful tool, know which language they have to read the document in. So if I'm not completely blind, but above the age of 65 or maybe below, I might like to use larger texts. I mean, I wear glasses. I'd like to have larger texts. And it should be simple that you can zoom in on web pages and have the text in larger font sizes. And the same with contrast and colors on pages. These are the most important points of accessible navigation. There are far more, but these let us derive certain things such as text editing, which is something that everybody, all of us do all day. And I really encourage you to use formatting templates. And you should, either you or the institution you work for, should create and use these, because they have predefined styles for headings and lists and tables that are really easy or well to read for technical tools such as screen readers or braille displays. And if I use these instead of, for example, creating page breaks with by hitting the enter key 50 times, which can really throw off screen readers. You should also avoid using long runs of italic texts. It makes it really hard to read for people with certain visual or cognitive impairments. They might prefer larger fonts and non-italic text. And the same with justified text. I'd recommend having it left aligned. Lots of text editors, all the way from Microsoft Word to open source software, have options to check the accessibility of a document, which I can really recommend.
Machst du mal bitte weiter?
PDF. Is the most universal file format for text documents, also probably the most used one. And it isn't accessible, but there is a standard for accessibility in PDFs, which is very long. And there's also the well-known Matterhorn protocol, which implements this ISO guideline. It's a very long list, and there was no way to check it or in an automated way. You really had to implement it manually and then check it manually. If I have a good text document, which is manually, which is accessible and which I checked, and then I turn it into a PDF, then I've already come quite far. But if, which you might remember from university, you just have a scan from book, then that's stored as a graphic, which isn't really accessible. So there are different ways to create a PDF, and I can only create a good foundation with the original document.
And
these tools check if the PDF has a good structure, a logical reading order, good navigation for somebody who cannot see the document. So information shouldn't be conveyed through purely visual means. People might tell you, well, it's a text, it's not an image. But no, if you scan something and don't use OCR technologies, then that text is not going to be accessible. Videos are also quite popular in teaching. And many of you probably like to watch YouTube from time to time. To start, videos have to be reachable in an accessible way. I mean, there's no point if the video itself is accessible, but you can't get to it. So you have to be able to press the start button. What is a video if I can't hear anything? Probably need subtitles. You can have a look at this in our documentation, but important visual information has have to be conveyed through audio descriptive means. Dinner for One, for example, which is a famous sketch in Germany, I can highly recommend watching it with audio descriptions on. Have a look at it. You're going to definitely find it on a TV near you over the next 2 days. But also the Tatort crime series tends to have audio description. And what happens during development? That's a very broad subject as well, but everybody who participates online probably handles a text document at some point, but new developments, what about them? Apps, for example, you might be tempted to say, well, we're going to create a tool and then disabled people can do this or that, and that I deliberately phrase it this way because it's something I hear very often, but and I noticed that the target audience isn't really being, they're not really speaking to them. People tend to say, well, I heard this at some point, instead of actually speaking with these people and speaking with people with disabilities. And they can tell you what kind of time challenges there might be. Design thinking offers the persona concept, which invites you to think about who the typical user might be, and that could be something said like a ticket machine. How are ticket machines used? And it then invites you to conduct interviews with them and ask them questions and hear their wishes, and finally you should develop something, and very early on you should test it with these user groups. That's a real problem. People tend to take the first step in asking people, well, what you need, and then this influences the requirements. But then these intermediate steps are often not done, which again is testing things very early on. And why do people skip these steps? Well, it's often because homogeneous groups tend to develop these technologies, these apps. So I can highly recommend having a diverse team of developers. So not just software developers, but also people who are in touch with a certain target audience all day, and have them be part of your development process. This can be interesting because I can never maybe show the whole spectrum, but this helps. If you develop for older people, there's a bit of a threshold to asking these people, because they, you know, you might think they won't get it anyway. So again, I can only recommend this. McKinsey said this recently, but it's not a new insight that diverse teams develop better. So I would like to hand over to Robert for the technical part of this presentation.
Yeah, blind or bigger, diverse people with other impairments I haven't had very often in my teams of development, but if you look at software development, there's little attention for those issues, because it's not the perception is very low, because most of the people can do everything. So I have heard that blind people know the source code way better, because they can memorize a lot of things in their short-term memory, and that's something has to get into the test and the design documents much or so, and
so
everybody can try and install a screen reader and take a look what it's doing and why this is happening. And that's this part is about. I have planned to cover a lot of techniques, but I noticed that this topic is very wide and diverse, and there are many, many aspects. So I decided to show it rather on HTML with the bridge, how it works in different technologies. HTML is like Twitter, so it's about creating text. But on the other hand, also you can like program with it in a graphic interface. So there were a lot of developments within the last years, and all the UI frameworks are pretty good and pretty complete.
Liste nicht vollständig. Wesentliche ist
so, yeah, what is it about from the technology perspective? It's about the accessibility tree.
Also, je nachdem, was man
it depends on what you design in your application. There are APIs already of the operating systems. So there is Microsoft Active Accessibility API, so there are other for Linux, there's the accessibility toolkit, and for Mac it's the Carbon accessibility model. Those are APIs who are integrated in the GUI frameworks, and the frameworks provide information to those APIs, and the screen readers can integrate this and give some output which fits here. What does an accessibility tree need? It needs context information. Is this an address? Should it be stronger? The voice should be put stronger. Is it a navigation element or is it something rather hidden? All this has to be put in by the developer. So there is a HTML5. There are new tags in HTML5. So for HTML4, there were area tags. They are still existing, but rather avoid area tags and rather use HTML5. But there are cases the old ones are still usable. So let's start with general recommendations. Just encourage using the keyboard. It's about Alt-T and Alt-X. You saw it more often in the past, but you see it now not so often anymore, so it's difficult to put it to the right order. So pictures are a plus, but if there is text information in the picture as an alternative to that, then put an alternative there or put in a role. And rather having more text and less formatting, like putting a wildcard or an asterisk there, that's not so good for the that gives more information to the screen reader what went wrong than making it italic or red. So respect the scheme of the colors of the interface and don't put too many custom designs and colors and graphics, so it's not helping if it's not following the standards. So that's rather keeping to the standards and not using the dark mode too much. And working scale invariant, so with the current frameworks, that works very well. For instance, GTK, they all have this. With Windows Forms, there might be a problem. With HTML, that works. field validations you should do as early as possible. Yeah, think about it, how somebody is doing it with the Braille device. So they go out of the field, and if something goes wrong, they want to know it right away and not with a message in the end, like in HTML. So when you press the submit button, then there's a text message, the form couldn't be submitted. Please correct the red marked fields. So the blind person would say, what is the red field? And the green and red impaired person, that's a summary. What's important, Ray? So labels are associated directly to control elements. You have to describe pictures. That's what we, that Corolla already explained for complex controls, like spreadsheets. They don't fit into the known area roles. The accessibility tree APIs provide, so you have to deal with shortened or custom items, so it's still readable. And Unicode, think about Unicode and yeah, every sign is a letter. How does it work in HTML?
HTML machen.
HTML, yeah, you please use HTML5.
Seit, ja,
this is in place since, so it has new text.
Also H3 natürlich nicht und P, aber
so label address and
diese
navigation
berollten
items.
Dazu gleich noch mehr.
And there are also area text, but they only
aktueller Trend, anders geht glaube ich schon gar nicht mehr,
add to that.
Skalierbar, wenn ein
if an HTML page is responsive, then you can also scale into it, and you can still see the text and nothing breaks. And the color scheme of the operating system still can be changed.
Software-Programmen funktionieren
yeah, if you have, you have to notice that. And focus management is also important. Regarding the navigation menu,
komme ich gleich. Wie sieht's jetzt dann?
So how does it look like as a technology? So here's an example of a Notepad++. I copied a checkbox. And it has an input focus. So I'm getting from the API, from the accessibility tree, a control box. So the status is deactivated, but it's focused. So the screen reader knows a lot from that already. And the name is associated, which is Zeilennummern drucken.
Das könnte man jetzt
in HTML you can realize that that you see the same information in the accessibility tree. So there's input checkbox, and there's a label for this ID, and the screen reader will find it that way. Is there no right label?
Man möchte einfach nur so,
maybe you just want to put a graphic behind it,
um das dann barrierefrei zu kriegen,
then you can put a title attribute as well. It's not being seen, it's only a tooltip then. But you can also do it with an ARIA attribute, but that's not recommended.
Oder wenn man eben ein
alternatively, if you want to do another control element, like a checkbox box, which is an image, then you have to put a role attribute. You say it is in fact a checkbox and it should behave like a checkbox, so your screen reader and your Braille device knows that then too. So this HTML form has the new text in there, field set for instance, or legend, or label.
Zu dem jeweiligen Input.
And input.
Und
what else we got? That's all.
Zuordnung.
this.
Natürlich das Thema noch
so getting a little bit more deeper into it, we see something that applies to software development and HTML.
Also die Rolle Banner, Complementary.
So there are the roles banner, complementary, content info. There are HTML5 elements who have this context with them.
Das kann man dann alternativ.
You can do this alternatively with ARIA roles as well, but it would be better to use the nav element right away, and that is then already the navigation or the menu,
how
you can navigate through the website quickly. So there are some shortcuts for your keyboard, like Shift-H,
so
you can directly navigate to a certain part.
Ja,
how does it look like for the other frameworks?
Die, machen im
they do the same way like a browser,
der ja HTML als,
which is using HTML as a good description language. They build the same accessibility tree with some bugs here and there. But the most important part is, as a developer, you have to make sure that the controls are associated to each other and use the information. So WPF has a title and a help text attribute, so you should use that. And you should keep to the order of the tabs as well.
Und,
the problem is the same.
Da braucht man nicht, also es ist
it's just
nur anders geschrieben.
Written differently.
Zum Schluss,
in the end, I wanted forward back to.
Aber die hat sich schon ausgeklinkt. Barrierefreiheit by default denken.
So, the conclusion is think about accessibility by default, not only when somebody asks for it, just do it right away. And
nach dem Credo nicht über uns, sondern und ohne uns zu machen.
Humans with impairments do it not over us, do it with us. And
aktuell hat das Thema halt einfach noch
and the topic is not enough important so far, and that's why we as a designer we have to be included in those developments. You should use templates and build templates, and here we see some links and also some text-based links. So we have more questions.
10 Minuten haben wir ungefähr noch Zeit.
We have 10 minutes left.
Im Web IRC, den Link findet ihr in der Nähe vom Stream. Und bis dahin haben sich auch schon Fragen gesammelt.
Okay, so we've already collected some questions. The first question.
Könnte oder müsste statt barrierefrei vielleicht barriereärmer gesagt werden? Ich nehme an, es geht darum, dass man ja vielleicht nie so eine hundertprozentige Barrierefreiheit erreichen kann.
So, also for do you actually need to reach 100% for accessibility?
So, it's not, there's no well definition for having low barriers or being accessible. So I have to put it that way. I have to set a goal, what I can achieve, and my goal is accessible.
Glas halb voll, halb leer.
Ja, genau.
Or, yeah, like a glass which is half full or half empty. So accessibility, there are laws and guidelines, lawful guidelines. So something with having low barriers would be a great milestone. But low barriers are is like suitable for people with impairments. And you can fill a lot of evenings with talking about that. So it's you don't have to focus On it works for just a single person and somebody who is, cannot hear, he can raise his arm and they can use the website that this person can use the website. So there is somebody in the family and he has, this person has a different problem, and so you have to change it again. So you should look for those cases from the beginning.
Ist wahrscheinlich so. Allerdings ist halt auch zum Beispiel beim Bau.
So, if you build a building, so there are strict guidelines and rules there, and but it's not being checked as much. But if you have an application, you want to build something, it's, if somebody is checking that, then they look very deeply if the building is accessible. And it should be the same for the web.
Eine zweite Frage aus dem Chat ist, was haltet ihr von Emacs?
A second question, are you familiar with Emacs Speak?
And so maybe that's for me, but I don't know. But I have heard about it from Emacs Speak.
Es handelt sich offenbar um ein Speak.
So this is a speech-enabled.
Genau, und vielleicht die nächste Frage. Was sind die besten Free- und Open-Source-Software?
What is the best free and open-source software and also hardware alternatives that are offered right now? Are there terminals in the open-source world? Are there accessible
arme GUIs und
or GUIs that are interactive that are available?
Ist nur eine Praxiserfahrung. Also tatsächlich festgestellt, oder um es mal weiterzumachen,
die commercial offerings by Microsoft. Well, if you work somewhere where
wo das total it's schwer umsetzbar
where accessibility is really hard to implement and to get into people's heads, then I noticed Office that Beispiel, Office has a really good validation for accessibility and it's a good first step. In open source, well, everything that comes from LibreOffice, they have, I mean, they're pretty accessible, but you have to distinguish between the apps or programs themselves and what they produce. The apps themselves are pretty readable for screen readers, and the output is usually pretty decent as well, but I think to remember, I seem to remember that Word is better here. And GUI frameworks,
die geben sich ja relativ nah.
Well, I think GTK is probably the best, and as far as browsers are concerned, I'd hand it to Firefox. Chromium, the Chromium engine trailed behind for a while, but it's caught up. So now it's all pretty decent, and good open source screen reader. I think NVMe is pretty okay, which people tend to use.
Yeah, NV. Also, ich habe alles
screen reader app on open source. Well, NVDA, or NYDA, depending on your view on matters. It's an open source screen reader that I, as a seeing person, like to use. As a sighted person, like to use. It's pretty good for testing. You can check how an app works with a cursor and for a seeing person, but you can also close your eyes and try and navigate an app, or even just taking off your glasses if you're like me. WordPress is something that people, you know, who think, I'm going to set up a website I'd like to use, and there are some templates for it that are freely available and that have actually considered accessibility, but I unfortunately can't give you a list and tell you, hey, start here. I think there's a bit of a development backlog, and I have skim read what the Linux bubble has to offer on the subject, but not a lot so far. But I can have another look at it.
Kennt ihr vielleicht andere Open Source Programme, die jetzt nicht direkt
you know, other open source programs that don't directly help, but are actually being applied right now in everyday life with the media or larger networks, something that converts or takes notes or something that checks. Or how do you check something?
Let me check. I actually started with this at some point. I know, well, in video communication, Big Blue Button, which is pretty open source as far as I know,
lässt zum Teil halt eben diese Text-to-Speech.
Speech to text. It's not brilliant so far, but you can use it for video conferences.
Sie das Leben erleichtern und irgendwie Corona-Schutzverordnungen ermöglichen, aber halt Menschen,
which are often not accessible to people with impairments, and they're often excluded from these video conferences. And there are no privacy problems such as Microsoft Teams, who do the speech analysis on their own servers.
Ja, beziehungsweise ist halt auch eben mit so einem Bildschirmlesegerät, wo ganz
it's gut benutzbar. It's fairly readable or fairly usable with screen readers such as NVDA. Genau. What else?
Noch für schöne Tools im Angebot. Ich guck gerade mal ein bisschen.
Do you have any more tools on offer?
Genau, ansonsten diese W3, also die W3C.
W3C. Is an initiative on web accessibility, and they have a fair amount on their page.
Gibt's noch weitere?
Any further questions?
Die vielleicht letzte Frage, welche Ressourcen,
maybe the last question. What resources concretely? That are about Microsoft UI exist right now.
Sagt, die Programmierung gleicht mehr einer frustrierenden Trial and Error als einem gezielten.
So there's frustrating for programming to do trial and error.
Wo man quasi gezielt hingehen kann, irgendwie accessibility.
So what resources are available for Microsoft, or is there a portal for these different UIs?
I have one link that I can show you, the Object Inspector, which shows you what the accessibility tree does. I would share that with you later. There are some more resources on the topic, but I don't have a proper answer at this point.
Gut, dann war's mit den Fragen. Vielen lieben Dank an euch. Applaus.
Thank you, everyone. Applause.
Danke für den Vortrag.
Thank you for the presentation. Thank you to all the listeners who are all watching through the Chaos Portal.